Profile Audio presents The Celts, written and read by Simon Jenkins. Introduction. The most vivid account of the geography of the British Isles appears in the first volume of the Oxford History of England, published in 1936. It refers to the islands as created in two parts. The western part is ancient, mountainous, rugged, broken, irregular, scrubby, sour-soiled and incommunicable. In short, not a pretty place. The eastern part is a contrast. Newer, softer, warmer, alluvial and fertile, attractive to invaders. The authors of this history assured readers that, despite this distinction, the series would be all-encompassing. It would narrate the story of the islands of Britain as a whole. That promise was not kept, and is rarely kept in histories of the British Isles. Historians invariably direct their readers to the eastern half of the archipelago, the fertile, attractive side, called England. This bias is reflected in the attention given to the peoples occupying the two sides, notably to the conflicts between them, leading to the supremacy of the peoples of the east. Britons are taught from birth the story of England, just England. They are taught little or nothing of the others, notably the Irish, Scottish, and Welsh, commonly referred to collectively as the Celts. The first part of this book explains why the word Celt is a misnomer. As we shall see, scholarship since the 1960s has struggled to dismantle long-held theories of how the British people came into existence. This dismantling is important because, to a remarkable extent, theories of Celticism continue to fuel many of the prejudices and misconceptions that divide the peoples of the British Isles to this day. They both distort history and demean the distinctive characteristics of those Irish, Scottish, and Welsh nations. First among those misconceptions is that a people called the Celts invaded Britain from continental Europe sometime in the 2nd or 1st millennium BC. There has never been found a distinct people, race, or tribe claiming the name or language of Celtic. The word keltoi first appears in Greek, as applied generally to aliens or barbarians, assumed to be inhabitants of Western Europe before the rise of the classical world. In Latin, the term used is Galli or Gauls. Nowhere in this period was any such term applied to the people of the British Isles. Excavations in the 19th century of Iron Age sites at Hallstatt in Austria and Lutthein in Switzerland were declared evidence of a Celtic civilization, possibly one even stretching from Asia Minor in the east to Portugal in the west. Its artifacts, too, were granted the designation Celtic, the style in use to this day. As we shall see, early analysis of ancient DNA generally accepted that the peoples who occupied the British Isles dated back to a climatic migration northwards after the end of the last ice age. This migration occurred with global warming, primarily up the Atlantic coast of Europe from Iberia. On the eastern side of the islands, perhaps more recent DNA showed an occupation from continental Europe. There's little consensus on the balance between these two incursions, or when they occurred. Neither merits the title Celtic invasion. Probably in the late Bronze Age, that's roughly 2100 to 800 BC, these inhabitants of Britain came into contact with a variety of languages, then spreading across Europe, accompanying the growth of trade in metals. These tongues, loosely related to each other within the Proto-Celtic Indo-European group, were assumed to have permeated every corner of the British Isles, at least down to the period of the Roman occupation. That permeation is now doubted, with the eastern side of Britain thought possibly to have spoken some version of the Germanic of Northern Europe. Certainly, two completely different language groups were in use in the British Isles by the 2nd century after the withdrawal of the Roman Empire. This was attributed to another misconception, a further mass incursion, this time of Saxons, in the 5th and 6th centuries, supposedly either wiping out the Eastern Celtic speakers or driving them westwards across Britain. Like the Celtic invasion before it, this second one is also now discredited. While there are genetic signs of people migrating round the North Sea at the end of the Roman Empire, there is nothing to indicate a wipeout of its inhabitants and their total replacement throughout the length of eastern Britain. It is now thought possible that the many different peoples of the British Isles, east and west, evolved their own languages independent of any population movement. The East looked East, and the West looked West. This theory of a long-standing division, genetic and linguistic, between the peoples of the East and West of the British Isles remains controversial. What does appear to be the case is that the ancient geographical divide described in the 1930s by those Oxford historians became deeply embedded in the history of the peoples of Britain. It attended the cohesion of the Easterners eventually into one nation and the fragmentation of the Westerners. It was reflected in the boundaries of the Roman province of Britannia and in the emergent identities of the Irish, Welsh, and Scottish peoples. It was reflected in the supremacy of what became the first empire of the English-speaking Easterners. A uniting kingdom. The second part of the book narrates the course of that supremacy. Most European countries, however diverse their origins, tell their story as that of a nation-state being fashioned from various tribal agglomerations and unions. If one dominant group emerges, it must hold the others in thrall through military might and/or cultural assimilation. In her book, Acts of Union and Disunion, the historian Linda Colley describes the leaders of these agglomerations as having to operate on two levels. They had to nurture a sense of belonging and allegiance to secure the subservience of lesser groups. But to retain that allegiance, they also had to acknowledge and protect their partial autonomy and separate rights and cultures. They could never take those rights for granted. It was on this basis that European states were formed. Prussians, Hanoverians, and Bavarians became one nation as Germany. Burgundians, Gascons, and Savoyards became French. Romans, Venetians, and Sicilians became Italians. In turn, Alpine French, Germans, and Italians became Swiss. They fashioned constitutions that would hold together their disparate components. Only a very few failed, most recently Yugoslavia and Czechoslovakia. From the very start of their supremacy, the English failed to instill Colley's sense of belonging and allegiance among the Celtic-speaking tribes of the West. Nor did they respond to the Westerners' distinctive identities by granting them a degree of autonomy and separate rights. The tribes occupying eastern Britain in the 5th century AD formed themselves first into seven kingdoms, then into three, and then into one, England. By the 11th century, under Anglo-Saxons, Danes, and their Normans, England was among the earliest nationalized states in Europe. It was an early union. Not only did the Westerners never join hands and hearts with these Easterners, they found little coherence either within themselves or between each other. Unlike those of England, few of the clans or kingdoms of Wales, Scotland, and Ireland behaved as if they were members of some collective whole. Their efforts at self-government came constantly to grief, with rulers no sooner succeeding in briefly uniting their peoples than they died in feuds and civil wars. Over time, these Westerners did combine sufficiently to be recognisably Irish, Scottish, and Welsh, with distinctive languages and dialects. What they never did was unite against England. They did not speak a common language or acknowledge one leader. At the time of the Battle of Brunanburh in 937, against Athelstan's English, a Welsh bard did call for such an alliance, embracing even Cornwall, but it was never achieved. He did not use the word Celtic. Despite frequent revolts and conflicts, England was never to have serious trouble holding its neighbours in thrall. The borderlands roughly of Offa's Dyke, Hadrian's Wall, and the Irish Sea were to remain England's boundaries throughout history. Over time, the nations beyond them passed under English sovereignty, first by conquest and colonisation, and then through annexation. Wales in 1536, Scotland in 1707, and Ireland in 1801. An English empire was formed on the British Isles. But it was an empire of the most tenuous union, many of its members continuing to refuse to acknowledge themselves as British. Only in the 17th century did scholars begin to see the Isles as possessing a collective Celtic past, largely through the identification of a common linguistic root. In the 18th century, England's domestic empire did form a sort of community, with the growth of an overseas British empire in which Scottish, Irish, and Welsh were prominent as soldiers, governors, and migrants. By the 19th century, a united kingdom, so-called, was messily in place, at least under one monarch, one parliament, and one flag. But it was a union of convenience rather than of hearts. A disuniting kingdom. The third part of the book asks how and why that union began to dissolve. The answer lies primarily in Ireland, where for three centuries London governments had dismissed with contempt the Irish yearning for at least a degree of self-government. This was in large part through English antipathy to the island's dominant Roman Catholicism. The resulting rebellions and repressions led finally to Irish secession in 1922. While treated by most English with a careless shrug, this secession was described in the 1930s by the historian G.M. Young as the great failure, the one irreparable disaster in our history. I find it hard to quarrel with that judgment. Freed of Ireland, British politicians, who were then starting to dismantle their overseas empire, behaved as if the earlier domestic one could now be taken for granted. The outcome was as Colley predicted. The Scots and the Welsh took a lead from the Irish, and a new spirit of nationalism emerged. At the end of the 20th century, the same pressures that had lost Ireland were gaining traction in Scotland and even in Wales. At no point in debates about home rule, whether in Ireland or Scotland, was there any suggestion of a Celtic nation. The Irish, Scots and Welsh remained passionate in their separateness. No attempt was made to form a Celtic party or grouping of MPs in the House of Commons. Only in Celtic studies departments of universities was a sort of union recognised. Language remained the principal cohering characteristic of Celtic-speaking regions, except that there was no one Celtic language. Indeed, language, while a token to nationalist politicians, was a side issue. To speak English does not make someone any less Irish, Scottish, or Welsh. In the final part of this book, I considered the argument for small state independence. It's impossible to deny that Ireland has done well on its own, and impossible to deny that this has come largely about through its liberation from British rule, and in stark contrast to the experience of Northern Ireland, as well as Wales and Scotland. Whether the same factors would play in the latter provinces of Britain is a matter of now heated debate, but Ireland's experience should make every unionist pause. I'm half Welsh and half English, and have tried to rid my analysis from either loyalty. But I do believe that any well-constituted state should be able to accommodate diversity and prosper from it. A country's politics, culture, society, and outlook on the world should all benefit from such diversity. A Britain composed of England, Scotland, Wales, and, once upon a time, all of Ireland, must surely be stronger than one comprising England alone, particularly in England fast becoming a vast and dependent suburb of the London metropolis. Yet to realise the benefits of such a union, England must change its political relations with the non-English peoples of Great Britain, if not of the British Isles as a whole. It must find stability and cohesion by devolving to them ever greater autonomy through new federal institutions. It has to change its outlook as well as its constitution. To this challenge, I return later. Part 1, The Myth of the Celts. Chapter 1, How Ancient Were the Britons? A group of Mesolithic people, standing 8,200 years ago on the North Downs above what is now the Strait of Dover, might have witnessed an astonishing sight. At their feet was an outlet into the English Channel of two great rivers, now the Thames and the Rhine. To their north lay a series of marshes, relics of the land bridge that had joined Britain to mainland Europe across what was known as Doggerland. Our onlookers would have seen a cloud towering over the northern horizon, above a wall of water possibly 30 metres high. This tsunami had been created by a landslip off the Norwegian coast that would become known as the first Storegga slide. The resulting wave made landfall in northeast Scotland and left traces that can still be found 30 kilometres inland. It then swept south, submerging Doggerland and carrying millions of tons of rubble and sand, hurtling towards the downs on which our onlookers were standing. The impact would have been seismic. The water burst through a valley in the uplands and out into what is now the English Channel. Underwater archaeology has revealed scouring marks as the debris was dragged along the channel floor. What had been a peninsula at the western extremity of Europe was now the British Isles. During the following millennia, the inhabitants of this now maritime nation developed an agrarian economy, felling most of the virgin woodlands and evolving social organisation sufficient to build boats, exchange goods by sea, lay out settlements and erect monuments. Their faces have vanished. Their words are a mystery. Only fragments of their artifacts survive. These were the indigenous people we used to call ancient Britons. Ghosts flitting across the stage on which the drama of British history was later enacted. The traditional narrative. The prehistory of the British Isles was long the preserve of one profession, archaeology, fashioning theories often in a fog of inherited conjecture and myth. One such theory held that the ancient Britons were subjected to an invasion by a newly arrived people during the second or first millennium BC, outlier of a great population sweep across Europe from the east. This was thought to originate in the steppes of Russia, the Caucasus or Anatolia, impelled by the arrival of horses and the discovery of copper and tin in the late Bronze Age. These people were said to have occupied Europe before the rise of Greece and Rome, filling what scholars viewed as a vacuum in the prehistoric narrative. They were first mentioned as keltoi, a general term meaning little more than aliens, by the Greek historian Herodotus, roughly 484 to 425 BC, and later described by Julius Caesar as Gauls. Though sometimes given the names of individual tribes, these people were lumped together as Celts or more often barbarians. They were also assumed to have brought with them Northern Europe's first lingua franca, a branch of Indo-European known as Proto-Celtic. No one at that time placed the Celts in Britain, rather in Spain and France. The first mention of Britons is circa 320 BC by the Greek geographer Pytheas of Massalia, calling them Britanni or Britanni, implying that they were painted ones. The identification of people in Britain with Herodotus's Celts was suggested only in the 17th century, purely on grounds of language. A French priest, Paul-Yves Bezeron, first identified as Gallic the similar languages of his Breton compatriots and those of the Western British Isles. He hazarded that they were at some past time the same people. This insight was developed by Edward Lloyd, 1660 to 1709, a Welsh scholar working in Oxford around the turn of the 17th century, who classified Goidelic Irish and Scots Gaelic as Q-Celtic. He classified Welsh, Cornish and Breton as P-Celtic or Brythonic. Lloyd chose to group them collectively as Celtic rather than Pezeron's Gallic, apparently as a patriotic or non-French gesture. All were assumed to have come to Britain from France. Lloyd's thesis became received wisdom. It joined similar foundation narratives in nationalist France and Germany. Napoleon later imagined himself a latter-day Celtic emperor. German linguists and anthropologists hailed the Celts as the first Germans. The idea that this was all one people and one culture was reinforced by the archaeological discovery in the 1840s that Hallstatt, then and now a picturesque Austrian settlement, was a centre of salt mining and manufacture in the first millennium BC. This was followed by discoveries at Latein in Switzerland. Their excavations yielded artefacts of elegance and charm from what became two eponymous material cultures, duly declared signs of a great Celtic civilization. Who these people were, or perhaps more intriguingly, had once been, remained a mystery. In 1956, a leading Lithuanian-American anthropologist, Marija Gimbutas, discovered a people called the Yamnayans, who swept westwards from the Pontic and Caucasian steppes, roughly the 3,300 to 2,600 BC. They are supposed to have brought with them such wonders of Asian civilization as the horse and the wheel, ideal accompaniments to the emerging ages of copper and bronze. These incomers spread out across the Ukrainian and Hungarian plains, fusing their so-called steppe DNA with that of the indigenous peoples. How far these Yamnayans fed into the Celtic narrative is confused. The assumption is that circa 2600 BC, they mutated into the so-called Bell-Beaker culture of the Bronze Age, permeating westward across northern Europe and becoming in turn Herodotus's keltoi. This fitted neatly into the idea of a Europe constantly overrun and enriched by invaders. Hallstatt and Latein demonstrated a status sufficient to threaten early Greeks and Romans, a threat that suggested a mighty people. To nationalist prehistorians, they were thus fitting ancestors to the later glory of France and Germany. By the 1920s, the French historian Albert Grenier could declare the Celts nothing less than an empire, possibly the greatest power in Europe inexhaustible in energy and human might. This concept of a Celtic empire continues to dominate maps and histories of Celtic Europe to this day. Geographers, like historians, cannot bear gaps. They seek links, commonalities, lines of invasion, influence, and power. Whatever was West Europe's pattern of occupation, and DNA may yet clarify this, it had evaporated by the time of Rome's expansion northwards. By now, the Celts had become a people massively dispersed and reduced to tribes. They had expanded, or possibly been driven by new invaders, to the extremities of the continent, clinging to the wild Atlantic shores of Spain, France, and the British Isles. In the case of Britain, they were portrayed as replacing the entirety of the population with their language and culture. With the decline of Rome, their old lands were now overwhelmed by new waves of intruders, Franks, Goths, Huns, and Vandals. Thus, the Oxford History of England was unequivocal. It described Britain as a refuse heap on the edge of the ocean into which are swept the outworn relics of ethnic migrations. Britain had become the Celts' last redoubt. Chapter 2. The Kelto-Skeptic Dawn. The narrative crumbles. Already in the 1960s, this Celtic narrative was being challenged. The oft-cited empire suggested by Hallstatt and Lutyens was supported by no other imperial settlements. There was no evidence of people in Austria, Switzerland speaking anything like Celtic, nor did historians regard it as plausible for entire peoples and languages to be obliterated by D-Day-style invasions, landings, and genetic replacements. Ancient civilizations did not evolve in this catastrophic way. Prehistory now became an academic confrontation. In 1966, the Disney Professor of Archaeology and Ethnology at Cambridge University, Sir Graham Clark, was dismissive. He described the traditional Celtic narrative as suffering from invasion neurosis. He objected to ancient Britons being seen as dimwits clad in druidical garb, figures of fun if not of scorn, needing to be taught a lesson in Bronze Age civilization by incoming Celtic warriors. The inhabitants of the British Isles did not need conquerors to help them advance in trade and technology. There was no reason to posit any assault, wipeout, or swamping, just because a people appeared to acquire a new language. Clark's Oxford contemporary, the Anglo-Saxon scholar J.R.R. Tolkien, derided the whole idea as nothing but a fabulous Celtic twilight, a magic bag into which anything could be tossed and anything retrieved. It was still one of which he made full use as a novelist. Prehistoric archaeology was long a closed shop, confined to scholars of things, of mounds, walls, pots and jewels. In the second half of the 20th century, it was transformed by the arrival of physicists, chemists, pathologists, anthropologists and linguists. The radiocarbon dating of plants and organic matter revised chronologies. In the 1990s, the application of ancient DNA, ADNA as it's called, to human skeletons revealed their life cycles in extraordinary detail. Bones, teeth, skin, even feces began to tell their tales. The dating of Britain's oldest resident, the so-called Red Lady of Paviland in South Wales, was revised 30,000 years, from early Roman to before the last ice age. She turned out to be a Paleolithic young man with a taste for fish. Stonehenge's Amesbury Archer of 2300 BC was revealed as Swiss, with a tooth abscess and a gammy leg. His partner came from Kent. Science had revolutionized archaeology. By the 1990s, the skeptics were in full cry. The anthropologist Malcolm Chapman published his Celts: The Construction of a Myth in 1992, describing them as mere others of ancient Europe. They filled a gap in Europe's story with an apparent continuity and substance. The word Celt had become so obfuscated that Chapman suggested it be banned from academic discourse altogether. British Museum archaeologist Simon James in 1999 likewise dismissed the Celts as an 18th century invention. Calling them a specific people was a political falsification of history, dangerous in the hands of separatists. It was as if history lay not in the mountains and seas of Britain, but in the minds of feuding scholars. The French historian Graham Robb, in his The Discovery of France, wrote that to gather under one name the myriad peoples who once inhabited Europe was anyway a fallacy. They did not see themselves as such. They owed loyalty to a family or clan tradition and to territory on which they'd been settled. As for ethnic identity, Rob pointed out that it had been long eroded, or at least delegated to the wizards of DNA, that certain people once shared a language to help communicate with neighbours meant nothing. English speakers do likewise, without becoming English. The Celts were simply a myth. The paths diverge, Celtic from the West. Faced with this blizzard of scepticism, the Celts' most ardent champion, Oxford's Barry Cunliffe, did not disown them, but he published two works, The Ancient Celts in 1997, followed in 2001 by another called Facing the Ocean, which were both firmly in the revisionist line. They drew on two influential insights into the study of prehistory. The first was the idea of the longue durée, associated with the French 20th century historian Fernand Braudel, 1902 to 1985. He emphasized the slow passage of historical change, often unnoticed over time, warning in particular against imposing on prehistory a template of events-led upheavals familiar in modern times, a high-speed chronology of monarchs, conquests, invasions, revolutions, and imported technologies. In particular, Braudel objected to attributing every advance in human behavior to an external agent. This was a reprise of Clark's invasion neurosis. Another insight was equally significant to the saga of the British Isles. This told ancient historians not to overrate contact by land compared with contact by sea. Before the advent of the horse, water was by far the fastest and most efficient means of communication. A journey that on foot could take weeks or months could be undertaken in hours or days by even the most primitive boat. It was by water that early contact was made and languages employed to facilitate it. This helped explain the swift advances of the riverine and insular cultures of the Egyptians and the Aegean Islanders compared with their hinterlands. Seaborne mobility around the coast of Europe rose dramatically in the second millennium BC, with the burgeoning trade in copper, tin, tools, pots, axes, ploughs, swords, and coins. Transport became an industry in itself. Families became extended communities that needed to converse with strangers. This concept of sea as land viewed the peoples of the British Isles not as English, Scots, Irish, or Welsh, but as those of the Irish Sea, the North Sea, and the English Channel. The infertile limestone ridge running from the Scottish Highlands down the spine of England should thus be seen not as a bridge, but a divide. According to Cunliffe, the peoples of the west coast of Ireland would thus have felt more akin to those sailing the Atlantic and touching the shores of Cornwall, Brittany, and Spain than they would to the peoples of eastern England. He noted that Western burials, indicating elite behaviour, manifest in war gear and feasting accoutrements, were similar from southern Portugal to northern Scotland. These people were not invaders or conquerors. They were descendants of the tribes that probably inhabited these shores far back in time. Advances in genetic archaeology were now supporting such a thesis, that the mass of the population of the British Isles was probably stable throughout prehistory. Analysis of DNA from ancient skeletons published in 1996 suggested that 70% of Britons alive at the turn of the 20th century were descended from the same people as had inhabited the British Isles in the Mesolithic or Middle Stone Age. Much publicity greeted the revelation that a local teacher in Somerset and three of his pupils shared their DNA with that of a 9,000-year-old skeleton found in the Cheddar Gorge. It also appeared that their ancestors mostly originated from a common source, the Iberian Peninsula. This strongly supported Cunliffe's thesis that a very high percentage of the British population, both male and female, are descended from hunter-gatherer pioneers who arrived before 4000 BC, and that the Atlantic littoral zone provided one of the major corridors of movement. This movement occurred long before the arrival of any supposed Yamnaians or Celts. Language remained a conundrum. Mesolithic Europe would have contained an unknown number of tongues. As in today's Amazon or Borneo jungles, land-bound people needed only to communicate with their village and neighbourhood. Seagoing peoples had to deal with strangers and needed a common tongue. This had made the Mediterranean the prime conduit for the western diffusion of what was called Indo-European, supposedly out of Anatolia or Turkey and the Near East. A second route eventually yielded the Germanic languages that spread, it is believed, more slowly to the north across the Caucasus into Eastern Europe. In 1987, Cambridge University's Colin Renfrew set out a proposed timeline for the Mediterranean diffusion that reached Italy, southern France, and Spain as described by the Greek geographer Strabo in the 1st century AD. Renfrew suggested that Proto-Celtic speaking might have reached the Iberian Peninsula as early as the 7th to 6th millennium BC. Here, evidence was supported by pioneering research into Iberian Celtic inscriptions by John Koch, an American linguist at the University of Wales in Aberystwyth. This was supported by a large database of European Celtic place names and inscriptions assembled in 2006 by Patrick Sims Williams, also in Aberystwyth. Celtic traces were concentrated in Iberia and western France, but died out going east, though Sims Williams favours France for Celtic language origination. Celtic as the lingua franca of Atlantic trade now took on a life of its own, detached from any necessary link to race, tribe or population migration. Cunliffe dubbed his Celts from the West as merely users of a language that permeated northwards up trading routes from Portugal across the Bay of Biscay to the western extremities of the British Isles. He suggested this may have begun as early as the 3rd millennium BC, associated with the spread out of Iberia of the so-called Beaker culture, with the transition to the Bronze Age. In this case, Celtic might almost be called the language of bronze. To Koch, the evidence of Iberian Celtic finally loosened the long-held spell of the Hallstatt and Latin cultures on the origins of the Celts. Cunliffe echoed Chapman in wondering if Celtic languages might better be named Atlantic. A 2006 survey of this genetic revolution by Stephen Oppenheimer in his compendium The Origins of the British confirmed the scepticism of prehistorians since the 1960s. There was, he wrote, no clear direct evidence, linguistic, archaeological or genetic, which identified Central European cultures as Celto-linguistic homelands. A steppe origin for Celtic Europe was one of the last remaining archaeological myths left over from the 19th century. To Oppenheimer, it might almost be regarded as a hoax. There was a Celtic group of languages, now identified as a common tongue carried north by Cunliffe's peoples of the sea, but there were no Celts, just sociable sailors. The steppe strikes back. Genetics had certainly transformed the debate on Celtic origins in the 1990s, but it did not rest. By the late 2010s, laboratories across Europe and America were studying a wealth of ancient genome material pouring in from European excavation sites. Initially, this confirmed that the British Isles were originally peopled roughly two-thirds from Iberia and one-third from Northern Europe. Iberian DNA was close to 100% down the western half of the British Isles, but so-called steppe DNA rose to near 40% towards the North Sea. In 2015, a survey of the origins of the peoples of the British Isles provided a new X-ray of Britain's past. The survey did not undermine the earlier divergence of Iberian versus steppe origination, but it did offer a more fine-grained account of the occupation of the British Isles. More intriguing was the mapping of genetic clusters. This agreed with a marked difference in clusters between the West and the East. But the most noticeable feature was that those in the West seemed markedly diverse, while those in the East seemed synthesized over large areas. It was as if genes were reflective of geography, perhaps not surprisingly. The 2015 survey found that in the West, an Atlantic population that dates back to the Neolithic or even Mesolithic remains unchallenged. These Celtic speakers appeared fragmented and isolated, forming tightly differentiated communities, constant over time. They did not mix genetically or linguistically right down to the 20th century. Other distinctions were even more specific. The Cornish clusters changed at the Devon border. The North Welsh were different from the South Welsh, Lancashire from Yorkshire, and the Scottish Highlands from the Lowlands. Anyone who knows these regions today will recognise such divergences. A Devonian acquaintance of mine told me he never felt comfortable in foreign Cornwall, while a South Walian once described North Wales as Taliban country. Archaeogenetics now began to reveal patterns that were anything but straightforward. The distinction of male Y chromosomes and female mitochondrial DNA suggested separate backgrounds, possibly between horse-bound alpha male raiders going in one direction and female slaves in the other. Then in 2018, new material from the Reich Genetics Laboratory at Harvard began issuing a mass of new data. This appeared to confirm Gimbutas's thesis in the 1950s of a large-scale incursion of steppe males, her Yamnayans, across East Europe in the early Bronze Age, circa 3300 BC. More serious was the indication that this incursion subsequently led to substantial population replacement in Britain, some suggested by as much as 90%. Generalisation was complicated by so much evidence coming from burial sites, possibly of mobile elites, unrelated to underlying populations. This was somewhat like saying that the Amesbury Archers' Alpine origins proved that the Swiss built Stonehenge. But it revived a flurry of controversy, reinforced by a further Reich cache of skeleton material in 2021, supporting a later incursion into Britain, in circa 1200 BC, possibly from France. It was suggested, in addition, that these migrants could well have brought a form of Celtic language with them, as was to emerge as Brythonic. The debate was abruptly blown open. There were now advocates of Cunliffe's Celtic language reaching Britain from the ocean, but others of its arriving from the east and from the centre of Europe. In 2021, Cunliffe and Koch prepared a compendium of essays entitled Exploring Celtic Origins, in which they accepted that much was changing. What seems now to have been an age of innocence, they wrote, is overtaken by a deluge of ADNA, a glimpse of tantalising complexity. It still seemed implausible that there had been a 90% replacement of Britons in the early Bronze Age, or in the later Iron Age of the first millennium BC. To Cunliffe, this would have required a genocide far outstripping the worst excesses of the 20th century. It was invasion neurosis gone mad. But he did admit to a new scepticism surrounding the evolution of Britons in the 3rd to 2nd millennium BC. New evidence was replacing old certainties, at least as far as the occupation of the eastern side of the British Isles was concerned. Prehistorians now felt they were hanging on the words of lab technicians, awaiting each new email with trepidation. The conundrum of language. What seems clear to a lay observer is that Europe in the Bronze Age of the 3rd and 2nd millennia BC was slowly emerging from a patchwork of hundreds of long-established tribal settlements. Links were formed by seagoing and then landboard trade, as peoples and their lifestyles were transformed by the arrival of metals. The population enclaves on the western side of Britain would have been hubs of this great economic awakening, possibly centred on the tin resources of Cornwall. It seems more than likely that these peoples would have become users of the Celtic root languages that were spreading up the Atlantic coast with the trade in metals. Linguists tell us that Celtic was once divided into some dozen languages. So-called continental Celtic may have covered northern Italy, much of France, Spain and Portugal. It has all but vanished. The six insular Celtics, still found in the British Isles and Brittany, were divided into two distinct groups, to the west Goidelic and to the east Brythonic. A reasonably robust consensus is that Goidelic travelled the Atlantic routes north from Iberia, touching the outer rim of Ireland and western Scotland. Brythonic kept closer to the French shore, crossing the channel to Cornwall and southwest Britain and extending north to Wales and much of the north. Whatever their trajectories, Goidelic and Brythonic each fragmented into different languages and dialects, mostly incomprehensible to each other, though Cornish and Breton claimed to be as close as Danish and Swedish. It remains extraordinary that this fragmentation never healed. Centuries of English speaking evolved a common tongue, but Celtic never did. This was despite its core language having apparently served as a trading lingua franca, as later did Latin and English. To be Celtic speaking was merely a classification, never to have felt the need for a linguistic bond. To speak a Romance language is not to be a member of a Romance people. The same is surely true of Celts. Chapter 3. East Side Story. Europe by the start of the Iron Age, that is circa 800 BC, was seeing the emergence of a linguistic divide between the various branches of Indo-European. One of two such branches, possibly the older, was the Proto-Celtic that has been traced to the shores of the Western Mediterranean. Another was the Proto-Germanic of Scandinavia and Northern Europe. These two language groups appear to have met somewhere across the great European plains of the Danube and the Rhine. That meeting was to divide peoples down the ages of Europe's subsequent history. Whether such a linguistic watershed reflected any great genetic or tribal difference, we cannot as yet tell, though prehistorians are dying for a massive pan-European DNA census. What we do know is that at least by the first millennium AD, and almost certainly earlier, some version of this linguistic divide was to run down the spine of the British Isles. This would not have been surprising, given that both sides were occupied by people close to opposing seas, some to the Atlantic and others to the North Sea. But while those to the west have now been given a plausibly coherent narrative, Celtic from the west, those to the east are revealed as having a more complex and indeed frequently changing background. Amid a fog of conflicting theories, all that does appear to be the case is that their ancestry does in large part reflect the so-called steppe origins of the peoples of the North Sea. These peoples remain a mystery. The Iron Age settlements down the coast of East Anglia and round Kent to Sussex were known by the Romans as the Saxon Shore. Once assumed to imply a shore threatened by Saxons, it is now taken possibly to mean the opposite, a shore inhabited by Saxons. The television archaeologist Francis Pryor has identified Saxon forts from Brancaster in Norfolk round to Roman Porchester near Portsmouth, with all the hallmarks of civilian settlements. This supports the theory that many would have been settled, possibly for a very long time, by Germanic-speaking migrants across the North Sea from the continent. It must be significant that all Celtic languages have cognates of Saxon for their neighbouring, usually hostile, Britons to the east. Sassenach, Sassenach, Sausnech, Sison, and Sauson. It would be odd if all referred simply to one small German tribe across the North Sea. More likely is that it was the name given by Brythonic speakers, for whatever reason, to the peoples who had long occupied lands down the east coast of Britain. As such, it would indeed be the case that a Germanic tongue, a precursor to the Anglo-Saxon language sometimes called Old English, might go back deep into the Iron Age and possibly before. Since this was before the age of writing, linguists must grasp at straws. They've established that the earliest traces tend to lie in the names of natural features, especially rivers. Crucial markers for trade and travel, rivers rarely change their names. Exhaustive research has revealed that very few rivers in the east of England have Brythonic names, possibly some using abba as mouth of, tame as dark water, and ooze for swamp. In 1953, British Celtic languages expert Kenneth Jackson divided England into two areas. One, roughly east of a line from Southampton to Yorkshire, has rivers almost all of whose names have Germanic roots. Moving west, his second area finds Celtic-named rivers more common. The same roughly goes for place names. The language scholar Richard Coates has found just 35 names he regards as Brythonic down the eastern side of Britain, among hundreds that are Germanic. When Londoners vacated their city on Rome's departure in the 5th century, it was not in some Celtic suburb that they settled, but in the ancient Old Wych, or Old Port in Anglo-Saxon. I find it hard to believe London's Old Wych was ever Celtic. The search for an Eastern tongue that might have preceded Anglo-Saxon has been a major academic undertaking. It was called by another scholar of this subject, Margaret Gelling, the obscurest question in the whole of English history. The geneticist Peter Foster, basing his research on the Anglo-Saxon saga Beowulf, proposed a Germanic language possibly unique to Eastern Britain, with an English vocabulary related to Norse as well as German. The Dutch linguist Peter Shriver has likewise championed an ancient English lingua franca, perhaps related to Old Frisian across the North Sea. This can only be called work in progress. Amid this uncertainty, we can offer at best a tentative picture of the people of Britain at the time of the Roman invasion. Those to the west and north of a line, roughly up the central limestone ridge, were mostly long-established, predominantly of ancient Iberian extraction. On most of the island of Britain, their speech was Brythonic Celtic, from the southwest up through Wales and the Valley of the Severn, to the Midlands, Lancashire, Cumbria and the Borders, and to the Clyde and the Forth. Goidelic Celtic took hold in Ireland, Man, and the Highlands and Islands of Scotland. The peoples of Britain's east and southeast, however, had long been subject to Belgic, Germanic and Scandinavian spheres of influence and settlement. They probably spoke some long-lost predecessor of Old English, though they may have been familiar with Brythonic as a language for trade, indicated in the scatter of Brythonic river names. This, I have to stress, is a conjectural but to me plausible resolution of the Celtic Britain conundrum. Chapter 4. Enter the Romans. Defining Britannia. The impact of the Roman invasion on the peoples of Iron Age Britain is hard to assess for the simple reason that they never told us. Apart from a few inscriptions, they wrote nothing down and kept no Homeric record of their past. For 3.5 centuries, we have only the limited documentation of their occupiers, the Romans. That conquest, at least after the initial and indubitable invasion, appears not to have involved mass slaughter, enslavement, or population replacement. Life for most Britons under the Romans must have continued much as before. In the century since Julius Caesar's probing expeditions of 55 and 54 BC, there developed extensive trading contacts with Gaul. Cornish tin had made its way as far as Italy, and apart from that, Caesar had written, "No one goes to Britain except traders." It had little strategic significance to the empire. British resistance to Rome was short-lived. In AD 43, the Emperor Claudius's troops under Aulus Plautius landed in Kent under the pretext of aiding pro-Roman tribes in the southeast against the aggression of the Cativolorni. Possibly Belgic in origin, the Cativolorni were located from around St. Albans into the Midlands under their chief Caratacus. His early defeat at the Battle of the Medway in 43 effectively secured the southeast of Britain for Rome. Conquest did not lead, as so often in European conflicts, to mere elite replacement and the payment of tribute. It saw the creation of an extraordinary infrastructure of towns and roads, forts and markets, temples and villas, the defining lifestyle of this still new empire. Rome also created a new politics, the concept of civitas, an ordered society of settlements under delegated local government and civil law. In its train came writing, entertainment, design, and religious faith, at first pagan and later Christian. Imperial culture was remarkably uniform. A tiled floor in the Cotswolds villa was the same as one in Libya. What we do not know was who occupied this conquered territory. Soldiers and merchants came from across the empire and would have spoken vulgar Latin. Colonists were regularly imported and even granted Roman citizenship to stabilize communities. Soon there emerged an assimilated Romano-British population, benefiting from the new regime and its economy, and loyal to Rome. There are few records of armed resistance to the empire, at least in the southeast, throughout the period of occupation. Within two decades, Roman authority had reached as far west as the River Exe at Exeter, the land of the Domnonii people of Devon and Cornwall, while to the north, a headquarters was built in 71 at York, in the territory of the extensive Brigantes tribe. So far, only the Welsh offered serious resistance, notably the Silures in the south and the Ordovices in the centre and the north. After the Battle of the Medway, the Cativolorni king Caratacus retreated to lead the Silures against the Romans, only to be defeated in 50. He fled north, but was betrayed to the Romans by the Brigantes. The Ordovices in North Wales remained troublesome until in 60 a Roman army under Suetonius crossed Snowdonia and besieged them in Anglesey. Virtually the sole chronicler of the early empire, Tacitus, described scenes of druids and black-robed women with dishevelled hair like furies brandishing torches, who initially terrified the Roman soldiers. But the Ordovices were defeated, and the Romans went on to build two of their most impressive camps on the Welsh border, at Caerleon in Gwent and at Chester. Caerleon indicated extensive Romanization in southeast Wales. Both bases boasted imposing amphitheatres that still survive. During this Welsh uprising, the previously compliant Iceni tribe of East Anglia revolted under their queen Boudica, protesting a broken treaty with her late husband, her flogging, and the rape of her daughters. Before Suetonius could recall his troops from Wales, Boudica attacked London, Colchester, and St. Albans, reputedly, if improbably, butchering 40,000 civilians. She was defeated and committed suicide in AD 61. Hers was the only serious insurgency of Eastern Britons against the Romans, and it had been sorely provoked. Britannia now hosted the Roman Empire with little of the rebelliousness seen in Germany or France. London became probably the largest Roman city in Northern Europe, but as a trading centre rather than a military base. How far across the British Isles the empire should extend was not decided. In 80, the governor Agricola embarked on an expansion north out of the Brigantes' territory to the line of the Forth and Clyde estuaries in Scotland. He sailed round the Orkneys and down Scotland's west coast, where he settled a naval base with the intention of advancing on Ireland. All did not go well. Hostility from the Highland tribes compelled Agricola to advance to a new base in Stirling, eventually defeating the Caledonians in a set battle in 83 or 84, at Mons Gropius near Forfar. The Caledonian king Calgacus was alleged by Tacitus to have addressed his troops before the battle, "To robbery, slaughter, and plunder, they give the lying name of empire. They make a desolation, and they call it peace." It was to be the motto of imperial resistance down the ages. Agricola requested military reinforcements from Rome, but he did not get them. In 85, a sceptical emperor, Domitian, ordered him to retreat, and any further conquest of Scotland, let alone of Ireland, was abandoned. Tacitus, Agricola's son-in-law, described him as angry at being summoned home. Caledonia was per domita et statimo missa, no sooner conquered than let go. Even Trajan, the most expansionist of emperors, had no interest in Scotland, declaring a boundary with what Rome regarded as unstable territory. The Picts, as the Caledonians came to be called, were left alone, as were Ireland's tribes, some confusingly named the Scotti. Agricola's ventures marked the effective limit of the Roman Empire in the British Isles.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.